year for the A-10. I think we've got a great group of teams, great group of coaches and players, some returning, some new. From our standpoint, we're excited about the start of basketball season and what we get a chance to do with Dayton. I really have enjoyed the group that we've put together up to this point, just the chemistry we've been able to build. And we're still in the early stages of practice. We're about a week, 8 days into practice, so we're still learning about ourselves and trying to figure out how to be the best version of the team that we have this year. But certainly looking forward to getting started here in a few weeks.
Thanks, Coach. We will now open the floor for questions.
Anthony, I know you
back here in the back.
Patrick Stevens in the back.
I know you picked up a couple veteran transfers in Posh Alexander and Zed Key in particular. Just how well have they kind of fit in with your group in the offseason heading into the preseason, and just how much are you guys going to lean on both of those guys this season?
Yeah, so we've got five newcomers to our group with obviously a group of returners as well, but specifically, you know, work for, you know, Posh and Zed, and I would throw Jacob Connor in there. These guys come with a level of experience having played college basketball. For Posh and Zed, they're in their fifth year. They come with a level of experience from Ohio State, and for Posh at St. John's and Butler. And so, you know, just the fact that they're really experienced in college basketball, their learning curve, you know, being experienced guys has been a lot easier in terms of their adjustment. And I would throw Jacob Connor in there as well. You know, he played 2 years at Marshall, and high basketball IQ guy that's familiar with Dayton, being from the city of Dayton. So they've been great additions along with our freshmen.
If you have a question, please raise your hand and we'll get a microphone to you.
Gentlemen, Zach Weiss, Pittsburgh Sports Now. For both of you, in what area do you feel that you've grown the most this season, and how have you used intentionality to meet that?
Yeah, I think just with the coaches adding the new pieces and stuff, I think getting the new guys in and bringing some core returning guys, I think we've, over the course of the summer, we've had, you know, some time to spend together, and I think we've created a lot of chemistry. So I think that's been really key in how we're developing, and I think it's really special just to see how we're coming together so far.
Yeah, I would say other than my waistline, I would agree with Nate in that, you know, this is new for us. You know, we haven't started really any outside competition up to this point. So everything that we're learning about ourselves has been, you know, us, you know, just learning a new system offensively and defensively. We'll have to play differently, you know, and so just getting ourselves familiar with what our guys are really good at, you know, and help them play to their strengths and help the team, you know, become the best version of itself.
Nate, how different are you guys without Duran, and how ultimately, you know, has that off-season adjustment been? I'm sure by the time you get to the season, it's fine, but just what do you see is going to be different about you guys as a result?
Yeah, obviously when you lose a player like Duran and his caliber, you know, the team's going to be different. I think kind of the point of emphasis is just bringing the new guys in and having them learn this system and then learning what we're good at. You know, just playing together, practicing together. Obviously, we're still in the early stage of practice, so kind of just molding together, seeing what that looks like, making sure everybody is knowing what they're doing and getting adjusted. I think that's just the biggest thing so far.
Nate, can you talk about your decision to return to Dayton this year after entering the transfer portal? And then, mm-hmm. Coach, can you talk about how important that return is and what he means to the team?
Yeah, I think, you know, that decision is, it ultimately came down to, you know, Dayton being home. You know, Coach gave me opportunity last year that, you know, I don't take for granted, something that I was always looking for in college. So don't take that for granted. And, you know, Dayton is home. Fans are special. It's a special place. So I think just realizing that and being able to reflect on that ultimately helped me make this decision. And, you know, I'm glad that I did it.
And I'll just add, you know, Nate's process was relatively quick in the grand scheme of things. I think he was maybe less than a week in the portal, and I think just as he just mentioned, having a chance to reflect on the opportunity that he had and just the vision he had for himself and what he felt like he could do coming back. You know, in a day and age now where the ability to move, I think, can be somewhat enticing with all the different factors that go into that and the different people that have a chance to have an impact on a young man's decision. Nate was able to look at things and make a decision, I think, was in his best interest. And I know for us, we're certainly excited that he made that decision, and we're looking forward to being able to continue working with him throughout the year.
Anthony, how do you build a roster in the age of the transfer portal? Do you seek a balance between transfers and incoming freshmen? What has changed in recent years for you?
Yeah, I mean, a lot's changed, David. I think, you know, when you look at a lot of things kind of hit at the same time, and, you know, from my seat, it almost felt like we took the approach that it was normal, but it really wasn't, you know, from COVID hitting and, you know, guys that were in college getting an extra year of eligibility. It kind of, and everybody's always said this, that, you know, it's the older teams that win in college basketball and college sports, period. And so you saw teams that had an opportunity to get old and stay old because of the fifth year. And then right after that, immediate eligibility hit, right, where guys could transfer and be immediately eligible to play along with having a fifth year of eligibility. And then on top of that, NIL came in where guys were able to profit off their name, image, and likeness, and also have an agent that could help them in that process, which led to some other things that were unintended consequences. Right? So all of that kind of impacted how you thought about building your roster. I think now, at least from what I see, it looks like there's starting to be a shift where at one point a couple of years ago, it was really, really difficult for a freshman that wasn't in the top 75 to 100 player to really have the opportunities that they had before because of what was available to you in the portal. Not that the portal is less important now, because I think it's a huge piece of college athletics, but certainly I think you're starting to see a shift back to the opportunities being there for more and more high school guys. So, you know, every coach is different in terms of how they choose to build their roster. You know, for me, it's always been about understanding the culture that we have, not only in our program, but at the University of Dayton, what guys fit and how we want to go about doing that. And so there's a mix, I think, that you always will have to have. You want to take advantage of all the what's available to you. But certainly, I think for us, we try to stay true to who we are big picture-wise.
One last question.
Coach, this is for both Coach and Nate. Aaron Bracey from Big5Hoops.com in Philly. Wondering what you guys think about the top of the conference, and specifically if you have thoughts on St. Joe's. They're going to be playing at your place on a Friday night on ESPN. Wondering what you thought about the top of the conference and St. Joe's.
Yeah, I'll start. I think, you know, for me, honestly, I don't know at the end of the day what the top of the conference will look like. I think that's still yet to be discovered. Certainly, I feel like, you know, when you look at what St. Joe's has on their roster, how competitive our games have been with them over the last few years, they got, in my opinion, one of the elite players in our league, and Eric Reynolds. I think he's a potential next-level type guy. And so I know Billy's done a great job in terms of the roster that he's built. Every time we play them, it's a great environment, very competitive environment. So we expect the same, but certainly there's a lot of talent across the league, all right? And some of it we may not even be talking about, may not be in the picture. I think if you look at where the preseason rankings were last year, you probably had some teams that nobody thought would be in position to win the league, like a Richmond or a Loyola. And they stepped up once we discovered, you know, what they had, and once they discovered what they had. So I think this year will be no different. I think there'll certainly be teams that people aren't talking about today that will make noise and will be you know, a team that everybody has to reckon with in the league.
Yeah, like Coach said, you know, the league it's kind of a toss-up. There's so many good teams. It's a competitive league. You know, you can't really predict what the season will bring. You know, St. Joe's is a great team. You know, coming in last year, just hearing about all the good games that had happened between Dayton and St. Joe's, you know, something to look forward to. So they're always a team that you, you know, always have to bring your best and respect because they have talent and they're a good team. So I look forward to playing against them and just against everybody else in the conference as well.
All right, great. Thank you, Nate, and thank you, Coach Grant.
Thanks, guys.
Good luck this season.
Appreciate it.